Hello and welcome back to our lecture Physics and Chemistry of the Interstellar Medium. This is lecture number 3. We continue with the topic on the motion of the interstellar gas and dust. Last week we discussed the basic hydrodynamic equations and showed an example application. This week we will continue and expand what we introduced last week by adding the effect of magnetic fields and move into the field of magnetohydrodynamics. We have 3 subtopics for today. Before we move to MHD, we will discuss a few characteristic numbers that can be used to characterize the behavior of an hydrodynamic or even a magnetohydrodynamic flow. We will then introduce the fundamental equations of magnetohydrodynamics and, in a third part, show some approximations to simplify the set of MHD equations and show a few applications. As a repetition, here on this slide we summarize the set of fundamental hydrodynamic equations that describe the behavior of a fluid. We have the Navier-Stokes equation, we have the Poisson equation that basically determines the gravitational force. We then have the continuity equation that ensures mass conservation. And we have the equation of state. We saw that this is basically the minimum set of 4 fundamental equations that we need to describe a fluid. And we expanded this by adding the caloric equation of state and the energy exchange equation to allow for a more realistic picture or description of the fluid by allowing for heating and cooling processes and energy exchange. We will now look at a few characteristic numbers that can be used to characterize a hydrodynamic flow. And we still keep ignoring any Lorentz forces, and we will also ignore shear viscosity. And we make the first assumption of a stationary flow, so that the partial derivative of the velocity respect to the time doesn't change. With this assumption, we can remove the first term here on the left-hand side. So here's a typo. Actually, this needs to be the velocity vector. We already introduced the sound speed, and with the sound speed we can replace the gradient of the pressure with sound speed squared times the gradient of the density. And we have the Poisson equation. And with that, we can write the divergence of the gravitational potential using the integral of the density field. And we then move to a dimensional consideration. So we look at the dimensions of the terms in the Navier-Stokes equation. And this has a few simplifying effects. For example, the time derivative, for example, of any quantity will be replaced by just the ratio of this quantity over the spatial dimension, some length divided by some velocity, some typical velocity. L over V has the dimension of a time, and the derivative with respect to the spatial coordinate will be replaced just by the ratio of this quantity over L. So we introduce some typical dimensions of our problems, so the spatial dimension L, a typical velocity V, and we use these to transform our Navier-Stokes equation into a dimensional equation. So we have the first term, density times some velocity squared over L. The over L comes here from the gradient, of course. And then we can look at the individual terms on the right-hand side. So we have the gradient of the density which can be replaced here with the sound speed, and the derivative then turns into the 1 over L term. We have the Poisson equation that can be written as density times 4 pi g density, some spatial dimension, plus the viscosity velocity over L squared. So with these terms, or these dimensional terms, we can compare the individual contribution to the overall forces in the Navier-Stokes equation. So the left hand term that describes the streaming motion is a combination of the term that comes from the gas pressure, for example, making the fluid volume expand. We have a term that comes from the gravity, and we have a term that is determined by the viscosity. Let's start by comparing the streaming motion with the pressure contribution. We see that we have here on both sides this rho over L term. So we can directly compare the streaming motion velocity with the sound speed. And the ratio between the two is called the so-called Mach number. That's the ratio between the streaming velocity and the sound speed. that describes the relative contribution of the two if m is larger than 1. The streaming motion is faster than the typical sound speed. If it's smaller, the sound speed is faster than the motion. So we can say that if the Mach number is much larger than 1, then the thermal pressure is not relevant for the gas flow because the fluid elements are moving much faster than the individual particles in every fluid element. And just to give you an example, when we look at the cold atomic medium, we already saw that the sound speed is in the order of 1 kilometer per second. And we saw, let's assume that we have typical streaming motion on the order of 10 kilometers per second, which gives us, of course, a typical Mach number in the order of 10. So typical Mach number in the interstellar mediums are always larger than 1. So we have typically supersonic motion, with the consequence that thermal pressure can be neglected when we look at the overall motion of the gas. When we now look at the comparison between the streaming motion and the viscosity, so the last term here in the Navier-Stokes equation, we compare basically the density times the velocity. Times the velocity with the viscosity divided by L. So we take here, we write this as eta over L times V over L, and we write this as density times velocity over L. So we do not, so the velocity over length term is apparent on both sides, so we just need to compare these two. And we can express the viscosity with the kinematic viscosity, which was this nu times the density. So we can write here rho times nu over L. And from this, we can now derive the Reynolds number, which is just the ratio between the kinematic viscosity times length over the velocity. That's wrong. Let me correct this. When we are here, we can ignore the density. So what we have is here velocity times L, and on the other side the kinematic viscosity. If these two terms are equal, they contribute equally to the overall motion. The two effects are the same. So what we write here is then the velocity times L over the kinematic viscosity. This is called the Reynolds number. And again, If the Reynolds number is much larger than 1, this means that dissipation, viscous dissipation, has no relevant effect for the gas flow. You know this from experimental physics, Reynolds numbers much larger than 1 are called turbulent streams, or produce turbulent fluid motion. We can again look at the typical conditions in the interstellar medium. For this, we need to now figure out a typical length scale. Let's look at typical length scales for molecular clouds in the order of 1 parsec, which is 3.08 times 10 to the 18 centimeter. We saw that typical velocities are in the order of 10 kilometers per second, so 10 kilometers per second, which is 10 to the 5 10 to the 4 meter per second, or 10 to the 6 centimeter per second. And we have to compare this with typical numbers for the viscosity. This is somewhat less straightforward. The viscosity nu generally is determined just by the interaction between the individual particles in the gas, so by the collisions. So we can write down the viscosity as sound speed times the mean free path length in the gas divided by 3. And the mean free path length, so when we have gas, is the typical length a particle experiences while traveling through the gas between two collisions. And this is basically determined by the size of the particles, so basically the larger the particle, the higher the probability to actually hit the particle, and it's inversely proportional to the density. So the higher the density, the lower the path length becomes, because higher density means we just have more particles and we will have probably a collision already here. So this lambda can be written as 1 over n, that's the number density, times the collisional cross-section sigma. That's just the projected effective area of the particles, and for neutral hydrogen gas, this is in the order of 10 to the minus 16 square centimeter. So, with this, we can fill in the numbers for the Reynolds number. So we have 3 times velocity times L over CS times the cross section. So we have 3. We have the velocity of 10 kilometers per second divided by the sound speed, which is in the order of 1 kilometer per second. And we have the velocity, the length scale of 1 parsec, so about 3 times 10 to the 18 centimeter times the cross section, 10 to the minus 16 square centimeter. And we missed the density, which is here. And the density is about 30 particles per cubic centimeter. So, here the units cancel out. And we have, as a result, a very large number, a Reynolds number in the order of 100 thousands, but in any case much larger than one. And this tells us that viscous dissipation can be neglected for the structure, for the overall structure of the gas flow, and that the medium, the interstellar medium, is highly turbulent. Okay, the next step is to compare the streaming motion with the strength of the gravity. So we have a density term on either side, so we ignore this, which means we compare velocity squared over L, and since we have one L here on the right side, we move it over. So we have velocity squared over L squared, and we compare this with 4 pi g times the density. And for simplicity, we just ignore the factor of 4 pi and the ratio between the left and the right hand side gives our next characteristic number. We call it alpha, the virial parameter, which is the ratio of velocity squared over g rho L squared. Now, the left-hand side tells us something about the dominance of the overall streaming motion, and the right-hand side tells us something about the dominance of the gravitational force. So, if alpha is much larger than 1, so if we have a very large virial parameter, then the overall flow is not affected by the gravity of the flow material itself. So the gravity is not relevant for the flow. If alpha is much larger, much smaller than 1, we have the opposite case, namely that gravity produces dominates the flow motion, for example, because of gravitational collapse. So again, we look at typical numbers for the cold atomic interstellar medium, filling in the numbers. Here we saw that 10 kilometers per second is 10 to the 4 meters, so squared is 10 to the 8 meters squared over second squared, and we divide this by the gravitational constant, 6.7 times 10 to the minus 11 meter cubed over kilogram second squared, times the density, and we are in SI units, so we cannot use number densities, but we have typical densities of 1.6 times 10 to the minus 27 kilogram times 3 times 10 to the 7 per cubic meter. And times L squared, which is in the order of 10 to the 33 cubic meter. Square meter. Let's briefly check whether this is correct. We had one parsec square length, which is 3 times 10 to the 18. 3 times 10 to the 18 squared is actually a larger number, though that should be 37 here. Because this is about 9 times 10 to the 36, so 37 about. Okay, but we are looking at dimensions here, so a factor of a few is not very important. So we are with an alpha in the order of the 10,000s. So even if we miss an order of magnitude here, we are well above unity. In other words, for typical conditions in the cold atomic interstellar medium, gravity is not important. We can also compare the contribution between pressure and gravity. So this is comparing Cs squared over L squared. Again, we pull over the L from the gravity term and compare this with the 4 pi g rho term. This gives us another characteristic number when we invert this to have the L in the numerator. We have, and we take the square root, we get again a quantity with the unit of length. And this is the typical jeans length, which is just the ratio between the sound speed squared and the gravitational constant times the density, again ignoring the 4 pi factor. This is called the jeans length, and we see from this term the jeans length, if it's larger than if the numerator here, the sound speed squared, is larger than the term in the denominator, then the gas pressure dominates over gravity. So if the jeans length is much larger than 1, this means gravity is not important relative to the effects of thermal pressure. We will meet the jeans length later in this lecture again when we look at instabilities. So I will just give you a typical number for the jeans length in the interstellar medium. This is in the order of 18 parsecs. On the scale of 18 parsecs, the gravity of the material in this volume defined by the 18 parsec has an effect that is equal to the pressure effect in this 18 parsec box. The typical streaming motions take place on much smaller scales. So we find that gravity is not important.